Today, we are bringing you another edition of our conversations with students who've done wonderfully well with their master's applications. Of course, in the first edition, we had a candidate who made it to UCSD for data science. And now we are bringing you someone who's had great success pursuing a very popular degree, the MEM, which a lot of our audience watches. So Bhushan, thank you so much for joining us.
No problem. Thanks for having me. This is a pleasure.
Always. And I'm sure the audience will benefit a lot listening to your story because it's so recent and also so very successful, right?
Definitely, yeah.
Bhushan, through the title of this video, obviously, that we're going to put in, we know the final outcome, right? So even the viewers would know where you made it to finally. So I'm going to rewind the clock a little bit. Yeah. You know, back to your undergraduate days. So if you can run us through, you know, your undergraduate education, where you came from, that would be a great start.
Sure, yeah. So I did my bachelor's in electronics and telecommunications from Pune Institute of Computer Technology. It's called PICT. It's not a standalone college. It's under the Savitri Bai Phule Pune University. But it actually has a really decent brand name in the US. So I started with electronics and telecom. But towards the end of my fourth year, I dived towards AI and ML, and I was doing a lot of data analytics projects as well. Ended up writing two research papers. One was during college, one was after college, but with a college professor. So yeah, I think that's basically what the bachelor's look like.
So thank you for that. And I'm going to ask you about the elephant in the room, if I may, right? That is what usually proves to be a fairly important factor. Your GPA, are you okay revealing what your GPA was during your undergrad?
Yeah, so I had like a really tough time during my college years because the degree was not something I was comfortable with, but I obviously had to do it. I didn't want to take a drop. So like my first year GPA was around 9, and then it dropped down to like 7-ish. And then like the final year, it came down to 8.23, which comes down to around 3.5 out of 4 if you do it in the US terms. So that was my GPA.
And what was your journey post-college?
So I was working here and there. It was like a very drastic journey because I was someone who was never really happy at one place. I wanted like things to keep changing every single day and to basically see that challenge every single day. So I didn't sit for placements. I think that's something that I did, which is very different than a lot of other peers. Because I didn't want to sit for placements, anything under 5 lakhs. And I think at that time, we were not allowed to sit for placements, at least in my college, above 5 lakhs. So I got hired laterally. Right after college, I was working with these two companies. I think right before graduating, I was doing a part-time stint with this company called Omdena Inc. And I was working with the startup founders directly. So they at that time, which was in 2020, I think they were doing like these AI ML projects all over the world for clients, let that be nonprofits or startups or SMEs or whatever it is. And I was working in the sales department, like sales associate, marketing associates, product sales engineer, that was the role. And after that, I was working at a company called Merkle Inc. It's actually like a subsidiary of Denso International. I was working as a SEO marketing analyst, product marketing analyst, basically. And then I joined ZS Associates as a decision science analytics associate. I was working there for 2 years, worked on interesting projects with analytics, forecasting and consulting. Basically, I wanted to explore the consulting phase. Right now I'm working at a company which is called ARS365. It's actually a national company which is getting there in terms of the whole national outreach. It's actually a competitor to CBRE, JLL and ISS in the facility management vertical. So I switched from consulting, data consulting, to strategy consulting, and I'm doing that right now.
So that's a very diverse range of companies, right?
Yeah.
In terms of you work, which of course in the narrative can seem convincing because you bring a gamut of experiences.
Exactly.
So, how many years of full-time work experience will you have by the time you start at your college of choice?
It's 3 years. Exactly 3 years.
3 years of work experience.
Yeah.
And that brings me to my next question, right? Because I see that folks with a little bit of work experience in general have a far clearer idea about why they wish to go to the MEM. Whereas with most engineers, it's like, I don't like engineering anymore.
Yeah.
So let me just move on with it, right? So what was the case with you? Was the MEM something you decided in college, or did your work teach you that you wanted to go a certain direction?
No, so I actually wanted to start with bachelor's, but that's a story for another time. But yeah, right after college, I knew that I wanted to go for an MEM degree. I knew a lot of other people who were going for the same degree as well. And I think since then, this is where it gets interesting, because since then, my only goal in life was to go to Duke. I really didn't care about any other college, didn't care about Columbia either. But it was just Duke, because I don't really know why, though. Maybe it's the chapel that they have and it's quite pretty, and I think I liked it that much. At that time, I didn't even know about Dartmouth, by the way. And since then, it's been since there. I think to answer your question directly, I feel like at this age, I think at this age, or maybe an era, if you want to call it, someone who wants to do an engineering management degree thinks about it from a perspective that, okay, it probably will have a lot more technical things. It's true in some cases, and depends on where you do the course from, for sure. But I wanted to stay in this domain because I could see a future market, no matter which industry you choose. Let that be supply chain, let that be logistics operations, as simple as that. Or maybe you go to data analytics, product management. I knew for a fact that the tech industry is definitely booming and I don't want to stay away from it. And that's exactly why in like the last 3 years, and that be through internships or part-time internships before my full-time, I tried to work around in any and every single domain that I possibly could, because I wanted to see where I could see myself going and what the industry is, what I want to target for the next 15 years. And yeah, so I think to answer that, a lot of people do that for sure. Yeah, they want to go and have like an easy life where they don't want to stay in touch with the technical aspect. But even with engineering management degrees, when you choose the right fit for you for the college and also the degree and the kind of roles that you want to work with, I feel like the technical aspect doesn't really come much when you come from like a work experience background. And even if I would have applied with internships, I don't think even then it would have brought in that much of an aspect, because I would have still targeted the roles that I'll be targeting right now, right? So,
okay, great. And we'll get into the roles and your future plans.
Then definitely, yeah.
Later part of it, right? But right now, I want to touch upon a little bit the profile and, you know, the past touch more. I think a good place to start would be if you can run us through where you've gotten in terms of MEM programs. I know it's a long list and we are proud of that you work with Gradvine and it's a you know massive list of admits.
Yeah.
If you could run us through that, I think our audience would appreciate it.
Yeah, sure. So I started applying in September, October, November. I mean, I started the process in November. I had missed out on most of the deadlines, and I think I didn't really care for those colleges as much because I didn't want to go there based upon my conversations with a lot of the then existing seniors at those colleges. So some of them were USC, Stanford, Berkeley, Harvard, Yale. They don't have these programs, but they were in my mind because obviously they have a big brand name, right? So I applied to Duke, Dartmouth, Purdue, Columbia, Johns Hopkins, Northwestern, Northeastern, UIC, your University of Illinois Chicago, and I got into all of them except Johns Hopkins and Columbia. And yeah, I think that's and I submitted all of my applications by January 5th. That was my personal deadline. People who I know who got into Johns Hopkins and Columbia maybe submitted it before, like maybe December starting or something like that. I would have definitely wanted to go to Johns Hopkins, but I got a reject in like first week of application. So I'm just like, okay, cool, that's fine. So probably that's not somewhere I am meant to go, something like that. So yeah, those were the colleges I applied to, and all of them were MEM. Only two of them were MIS, which was like my safety net sort of, because I come from a background where MIS would definitely suit, if not MEM. And I wanted to go to these colleges only is why I applied to them specifically.
All right. So you're sitting on essentially Dartmouth, Cornell.
Cornell as well, yeah. Duke, Purdue.
Duke, Purdue, pretty much four of the top, six, seven, right?
Yeah.
And we'll get to your choice, shortly. Again, sticking to your profile, you said you had a GPA of 8.2, 8.3, which is a good GPA, but there are 9-pointers who get rejected from this.
Obviously. Yeah.
All the time. Mm-hmm. What do you think stood out in your profile?
This is a very tricky question, because whenever someone asks me what worked out, I just go like, I think I was lucky. Then that's a fake lie, because I really want to be a little more grounded in this perspective. But I feel like my vision of what I wanted to do at that program was very, very clear. I come from a background where I didn't use my current work experience at all. So it was just based upon the two research papers that I'd written, the ZS work experience, as well as what else was it? And the online experience that I did probably. And yeah, I think that's about it. I didn't even use my Merkle experience then. But it's not about the experience. What I would suggest and what I would mainly want to talk about and what I probably did very, very differently than other people is that every college I applied to, even if I didn't have someone from Gradvine who was helping me out with the SOP editing, I made sure that I found a personal connection. I got in touch with them. I got on a call with them and I saw their SOPs personally. So I had to make that connection online through LinkedIn. And most of them were ZS people because I already had ZS experience. So I understood what they thought while they were applying and how crystal clear their goals were. Because when you're applying to these colleges, right, no matter how stellar of an experience you have, let that be in KPMG or BCG, for example, you need to be very, very clear in terms of thought and the presentation and the story as well. Like, I think I know where my mistakes were with JHU and Columbia. Is that the SOP flow, and I read it and I still regret it. And I think it's going to be the regret of my life. But the SOP flow was, I mean, it had content, right? You can obviously write content. You can use ChatGPT and write content. But you need to convince the person who's reading your SOP as if they're a five-year-old and be like, okay, no, dude, this person literally needs to be here. There's no other place he can be. So it's about that strategic thinking that I think Gradvine did offer a lot more than I had. And I think back then I was in a very confused space because this was my second application cycle. So the Northeastern and UIC colleges are from my first application cycle. So I already had those admits and I was thinking, do I really need to put in that effort? And I think I'm very, very grateful for Gradvine, and I don't really say this enough. And I really wanted to say that on call as well. So thank you for providing me that opportunity, because I didn't see things in my profile that probably the mentor did. And he urged me to put my application to Dartmouth when Dartmouth was not even on my list. And I got an interview callback within 2 to 3 days of application for Dartmouth. And I was very, very surprised there, because that's the first college I got callback from. And I scheduled an interview. And yeah, and that the interview was insane, by the way. Like, that person was in love with me or something like that. And the interview was beautiful. I feel, and I think in comparison to other people who gave the interview as well, my interview stood out personally, and when I listened to their stories as well, they also tell me that, dude, your interview stood out very, very differently than what we have had. And I'm just like, thanks a lot, man. I think that speaks a lot about the kind of clarity I had shown in my SOP. And I think that I think the only difference where Gradvine came in, and I really appreciate that, is that the clarity, because I didn't have that. And I think after that, the kind of confidence I got in terms of how I see myself and my portfolio, it changed drastically. Like, I would definitely say that, okay, GRE did maybe boost it a little bit up. I wouldn't say that if I had a GRE of 316 or less than 315, I probably wouldn't have gotten it. But obviously there are different factors, but one thing that was very, very different was I was very crystal clear as to what I wanted to do with the courses, with the professors I wanted to work under, the programs I wanted to do, projects I wanted to do, etc. So I think that's one suggestion that I would suggest to everyone who's going to apply now.
And I think the clarity with the interview also, and this is my input, yeah, is because you spend so much time working on the application,
exactly,
researching the college, it comes through, right? A half-baked effort, that's going to show when you're interviewing with people.
Exactly.
And thank you so much for telling me how Gradvine helped. It's really, really heartwarming. But a large part of why we do these videos is to tell people what to avoid, right? Of course, we get a lot of footage when our successful students come and talk about Gradvine, but it's about misinformation, right? So what you're telling me, clearly I understand, and the audience will understand, that cookie cutter SOPs where consultancies tell you that you fill a form and we'll write one for you, never works. With top
never kids, works, yeah.
Never going to work. So that's what we are hearing from your personal experience. It was a personal
help. Definitely. Like, I can add points there as well. Like, I feel like, I'll tell you, since this is my second application cycle, I can tell you that the first application cycle, I went with a consultancy. Obviously, it wasn't Gradvine. I was told to not have a story. I was just told to be like, dude, you need to just tell me what you did. And that's all. the flow of the story. I was like, okay, how does that make sense firstly? And I was someone who was working full time. And with ZS Associates, the work culture is such that you have to work full time. You don't have things to do otherwise. And I was like, okay, cool, dude. I think you know better. Please just take it and then just give it to me. I'll give you whatever I think I've done and you give it. My point with the difference here and the what to avoid is that when you actually write SOP down, it's also about how your life has been. And it's a very mixed blend of what you've done in your life and why are you aiming that course and what you've done with your life personally, emotionally, and then your professional work experience, let that be internships, etc. What to avoid is to not fall into what everyone is saying. Do what you think makes sense. And please consult someone who's actually good at this because they'll tell you what to look at and what not to look at. Even if you don't want to consult, probably my suggestion would be don't think that whatever you see on the net is something that's going to definitely help you. You won't really be doing yourself a very huge favor if you do that.
Absolutely, right? And that's what I tell students. Like at this point, if you want to do it on your own, respect, right? Absolutely go for it. Don't pay somebody to make your life easier. You don't want your life
exactly
to be easier here.
Yeah.
You want your application to be enhanced. So make
exactly
that judgment. And this brings me to a point where I was interviewing another student and he said, I got so annoyed with Gradvine because my mentor Suraj, who's my co-founder, he asked him for a sample SOP. And he said, I have 100 that have gotten into Carnegie Mellon, UCS, UCLA, you name it, but I'm not going to give it to you, right? It's easy to do, but it's yours.
Yeah.
Make the effort. It's not going to work. Thank you. I hope our customers, understand that.
I think I just want to emphasize on that before we move on. I really like that also because my mentor was Sai, who is at USC, I think right now. And he told me, dude, you do whatever you want. You call me at 2 a.m. in the night. Here is my phone number. I am not telling you what to write unless you tell me what you've done in your life. Because even if they see your profile, right? Even if you get on a call, for example, that is still one step ahead. It's not like it's guaranteed that you're getting an interview. Even on the call, you can't fake it. They'll understand and they'll see you coming miles away. So unless you tell your story, because if they catch you somewhere, you at least know what your story looks like, right? So I think that is another thing which I really, really like because I spent an entire month writing an SOP. And I'm sorry if I was invisible. I was getting a call. I just ignored it. So I spent an entire month writing an SOP, LOR and resume. And I sent it to him every single time I thought it was done. And he made me go through every single time with every single letter for at least 10 times. And I was just like, can you just like get it done with? And I had to wait till Jan 5th. But then when I actually showed him every single thing, he's like, dude, look, you can look at your SOP and you can tell me how much of a difference there is. And I was like, I don't think I would have ever thanked anyone enough at that point. And I think, that goes to you guys for sure. No matter how much I've cribbed to him personally, I've never really had a conversation with you before. Because I was comfortable with him and then I was comfortable with Yajnesh as well. So I remember, I think I wrote in the review as well that I was calling Yajnesh at 1 a.m. and being like, dude, what is this? What is this? I can't work with this guy. This guy is just like, he's just bullying me into doing things I don't want to. And then he's like, no, you have to go through this if you are aiming for like those top colleges. And then I see the difference now. And I really, really appreciate that for sure. No doubt at all.
Yeah, thanks for that. I know it's in fact the harder way to do it as an organization also, but it's the right way. There's no escaping the work. So you decided where you're going finally.
Yeah.
And where is that?
It's Purdue University.
Fantastic. And this is perhaps the most exciting part of the conversation because I
got
the lowdown from Yajnesh about it. Pat on the back for that because I get so many people, asking me, okay, top 5 MEM, Dartmouth is ranked about this, Duke is ranked about this. And then listen, we are guilty of doing MEM ranking. So that's probably the most viral video on the ranking. But I think, it's about fit, right?
If you're
in a particular area or certain career outcomes in a curriculum, a Purdue can be better than a Dartmouth, a Columbia can be better than something else, an NCSU
definitely
can be better than any of your so-called Ivy.
Exactly. Right?
When did you make that decision? After you had all your admits, or were you sure that okay, if Purdue ho jayega, to I'm going to go there?
No. So that's a very interesting question because I was confused. I was talking to Sai, I was talking to Yajnesh, I was talking to a million other people. everyone had their thoughts. And I think that's when I realized that, dude, no matter how much you talk to people, they're never going to tell you where you fit or where you see yourself. I remember, I think we had a very brief conversation where I was like, okay, hey, these are my admits. And we were just like, okay, what are you going with? And I mentioned in that text also that it was Dartmouth. And I think that was the most confused phase of my life. And I'll tell you why. Because like I said, I never had a Dartmouth admit. And I would never have a Dartmouth admit if I wasn't pushed by someone. So I did my research. Yes, definitely. I loved the curriculum. I loved the opportunities outside of it. But when I got all my admits, firstly, yes, I waited for all my admits to come. And I knew that I had applied to 7 colleges and most of it I already gotten and only 2 reject. So I was sorted. After that, and since the very beginning of January, February, when I was done with the application, it was always Purdue versus Dartmouth. And I was hopeful that I would get both. No matter if I get into Duke, no matter if I get into other colleges, they were never really in my running as well. Main reason why is because, like you mentioned, it's a perfect fit for me personally, because I started with data analytics, data science, product marketing, product sales, etc., etc. Now, for the last 1 year, I've been doing operational excellency and strategy consulting with this company called ARF365. And I've been working with supply chain as well. So the industries that I'm targeting right now, no matter what the role becomes to be, let that be product management, let that be product analyst or sales engineer or whatever that is. But the industry that I want to target is the supply chain industry. And I talked to a lot of seniors from Dartmouth and Purdue as well. And the reason why I chose Purdue as well, for me personally, was also the co-op opportunities that Purdue was definitely giving me. Like, I can start interning from Jan 2025 if I do end up securing those internships. And I can do that till May 2026. And that's like a one and a half year-ish sort of a time that I can start working while I'm studying at the course. And for me personally, there was no other course which was giving me that benefit. And like I mentioned, I know that this is something that has been told a lot, that Purdue is known for supply chain management, but a quick insight to the cohort that we have right now, 80 to 90% of people who have gotten into Purdue MEM are software developers. So I'm pretty sure that the next batch that comes out, we're going to see a lot of product managers getting into Amazon, Microsoft, for example. But yeah, so like you mentioned, perfect fit. And for me, definitely, because I want to be in this SCM industry, let that be whatever role that is. Like Walmart, for example, hires for product managers, but in the SCM industry. That's one example. So yeah, that is why I chose. But it took me like a good 1 month. And I literally sat down, and I think that's where another thing that you guys keep doing is, okay, write down your 15 years plan, because we need to write it in your SOP. That definitely helped, because when I look at my 15 year plan, which is obviously very variant to other people as well, it talked about SCM for sure. So I was very crystal clear that, okay, it needs to be SCM, no matter if I chose Dartmouth, which is a very hard reject, because I was crying the day I actually rejected it. Because my interview was, I think the best interview was with Dartmouth, second ranked Purdue. But Purdue was more insightful than like a very one-on-one conversation. I think Stephen is like a sweetheart. And I think I had a very different conversation than other people. And he was laughing. He was telling me about his stories with Goa and, I don't know, Sri Lanka and all of the places that he had been to. So yeah, it was very difficult to say no. But I mean, it was what it was. So it was very crystal clear that way. So my deposit deadline was, I think, 15th April. And then I rejected in the first April itself, and then I paid Purdue, and then I'll be flying off in August now.
All right, great. And you know, that's fantastic, because at the end of the day, it's your decision. You know,
yeah,
it's going to make sense for you.
Exactly.
And if you get into institutions at that level, there's no wrong choice. Like, honestly.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, yeah, that's what one thing I was told, that, dude, imagine it this way, that you will be saying no to them after getting an admit. It's not like they're telling you, okay, you're not even entertained at the table. So it's a very different thing. But yeah, I agree.
Absolutely. So Bhushan, when did you start your application process?
So I was quite late. I started it in like, I think October. So September, I gave my GRE again. And October is when I reached out to you guys, and you only told me that, dude, you're already late. And I'm just like, oh, damn, okay. And because November, by November end or something, most of the MEM applications who are actually people with like good talent and like good stuff on their SOP resume, they end up being the first people there with the application. So I'm like, okay, it's fine. I think I have a solid work experience, so I don't mind being late. But that's just my personal case. So started in November. The December, I gave myself the entire month and I took some time off work and I was writing my SOPs, LORs and resume, whatever. And then by January 5th, I was done with all my applications.
All right. And any final tips you have for aspirants who are going to start this journey soon?
I think only one tip. It's a very lonely road, but you need to bring out the best out of your own profile. Like every person has their USP, right? Like one, I'll maybe specifically talk about this. There was one question someone asked me, the interviewer asked me in Cornell interview, and she said that, okay, you're definitely looking at product management and whatever, manager and roles. I'm like, yeah. And she went like, okay, what is that one thing that you feel is very, very necessary while leading teams, right? And most people might give a very strategic answer or like something like that. And I just felt like empathy. I feel like if you're not empathetic enough to your team members and to yourself, I don't think you can put yourself in a third perspective and look at the problem and then find that empathy to be sorry or respectful or apologetic or even happy about whatever decision you've made and then accept that and move on quickly and then make a new decision. Because in these high-stake situations, you need to understand where the other person is coming from. Because, for example, if you ask that person to do something and that person goes and does something else, you just can't be like, okay, it's your fault and then finish it off. You can't act like that as a product manager, right? So, and she was surprised because she's like, okay, dude, this is like a very new answer. I've never really had someone come and tell me, oh, empathy is like my strongest strength. And I think that's just something that I would suggest, that be yourself and recognize what potential your profile has and try to make that stand out. Every single thing else is secondary. Your GRE, GPA, like I had 8.23, right? Like, I don't think I'm facing any issues here. Maybe my GRE stood out. That's a different scenario. But just find your own USP and exploit it in the nicest way possible, because they're going to also choose you for who you are, not just what your academic curriculum or your background looks like. So I think that's the only suggestion I have.
Yeah, absolutely. And it's always the overall profile, right? Like,
yeah, exactly. Yeah. You can't ever pinpoint and be like, oh, this went wrong. And that's why I know so many people who got into Columbia with 314 GRE. That's not like you can't defend it. You just need to know how to defend it.
Exactly. Right. It's all a well-rounded package coming through and your own unique
exactly
you bring up. All right. So Bhushan, I think one, first of all, congratulations. I don't think
Thank
Indian
so
students
much.
Enjoy the moment enough. I don't know if you did, but
I did.
You did. That's great, right? But sit on acceptances from institutions like Duke and Cornell and Dartmouth.
Yeah.
And, hundreds of years old.
Yep.
Legacies and stories that are well before our time and are going to last long after our time, right?
Definitely.
It's no mean achievement, and congratulations on that. And trust me, the experience you're going to have is going to be transformative. You'll be a completely different person, not the coursework. It's just that peer group.
I know.
Being
yeah.
on the campus.
I know. I understand.
And I hope you love every minute of it, man. Like, really.
Thank you so much. Thank you. And I, like I said, I don't think I thank the concept of Gradvine and again, anything you personally as much as I should. But I don't think I would be here if it wasn't for Gradvine. And in any which ways capacity, let that be in the late night calls. And I think Yajnesh gets a big, big shout out, because it takes a very calm person to answer calls at 1 a.m., 2 a.m. saying that, dude, hey, this is my question. I don't know what to do. And this guy was like, okay, I'll just get back to you in a minute. And he used to get back to me in a minute. And I'm just like, okay, dude, this is customer service at its top. So I really, really applaud the services that you're giving. And I really hope people choose Gradvine. And thank you so much. I think that's all I want to say to you personally as well. This was really, I wouldn't really be here if it wasn't for Sai and you guys and what you guys are doing. So thank you so much
absolutely.
Again.
And we never say that. We say that we were a part of your journey, but the success is all yours.
Yeah, I know. Yeah.
Yeah. And we are extremely thrilled for you, Bhushan. Thank you so much for agreeing to do this. And I hope that a lot of people watching these are enlightened. So that's the end of
definitely. This. No worries. Let me know if you need anything else from me. I'd be happy to help for sure. Yeah.
Absolutely. Right.
Thank you so much.
No problem. My pleasure.